Good evening and welcome to tonight's public hearing, which was required by Section 31 of the Code of the City of Norfolk to hear comments regarding a repeal of Ordinance 47773 on September 24th of this year during a regular meeting of the Norfolk City Council by a vote 7-1. Council adopted Ordinance 47773. This ordinance established an intergovernmental agreement between the Pamunkey Indian Tribe and the City of Norfolk and an option to purchase between the City of Norfolk and Golden Eagle Consulting II, LLC, and the Pamunkey Indian Tribe. The measures authorize the city manager and the city attorney to correct, revise, and amend the intergovernmental agreement and option to purchase as they deem necessary to carry out the intent of the City Council. We have made it clear from the beginning of this process that the city manager and the city attorney would be empowered to correct, revise, and amend agreements to carry out the intent of the City Council. And let's be clear, nothing has been signed and not a single parcel of land has been conveyed. During the time since the September 24th vote, the city manager and the city attorney and I have met regularly to ensure due diligence of this process. I am pleased to announce that after 2 months of listening, analysis, reviewing financial reports and documents, as well as evaluating the conclusions, recommendations, and implications of the recently released Joint Legislative Audit Review Commission report on gaming in the Commonwealth of Virginia, we are in the position to present corrections, provide revisions, and offer amendments. This is part of the legislative process. Senate Bill 1126, state legislation that was passed during the 2019 session of the General Assembly, identified 5 host cities for commercial gaming: Bristol, Danville, Richmond, Portsmouth, and Norfolk. Senate Bill 1126 also mandated that the Joint Legislative Audit Review Commission study gaming in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Senate Bill 1126 has a reenactment clause provision. The bill must be passed by the General Assembly in the 2020 session. Senate Bill 1126 established a local referendum, which will be held on November 2020. It has always been the Council's preferred option to conform and comply to Senate Bill 1126 and to have a commercial casino and a public referendum. Upon review of the feasibility studies, analysis of the physical impact, and the reenactment by the Virginia General Assembly, our amendments will conform and comply with Senate Bill 1126 and establish a commercial casino and have a local referendum to determine whether or not casino gaming shall be permitted in the city of Norfolk. Our amendments will align again with Senate Bill 1126 and the recommendations of the Joint Legislative and Audit Review Commission. Listening to your comments, expressions, and most importantly, your participation has been vital to this process. We have created a gaming committee chaired by Councilwoman Mamie Johnson and Councilman Tommy Smeagol on gaming to enhance the community dialogue with the city administration and to evaluate and assess the evolution of gaming in real time, all forms of gaming, gaming laws, gaming devices, gaming activities, and the impact of current and proposed gaming in the city of Norfolk. The committee will not limit itself to the examination of casino gaming. It will also address the impact of gray machines, charitable gaming, sports betting, online wagering, and the Virginia Lottery. I'm pleased tonight to introduce our city manager, Dr. Larry Chip Feiler, former associate vice president of Old Dominion University and an eminent economist, who will provide a presentation on an initial analysis of the Norfolk Resort Casino. Following Dr. Feiler, our city attorneys, Bernard Pishko and Ms. Michelle Foy, will present an overview of the option and last year's legislation. After these presentations, we look forward to your comments. When your name is called, please come to the podium, state your name, and please limit your comments to 3 minutes. And your comments must be germane to the night's presentation. Thank you. Dr. Feiler.
Thank you, Mayor, members of council. Good evening, everyone. Some of you may have seen these numbers from Monday night. My presentation is largely unchanged from that, but many of you were unable to make that one. And so I want to go through this specifically just to show sort of where we are internally as staff regarding an analysis of the possible resort and casino. So as the landscape has changed over the last 3 months, Team Norfolk, we've been putting together as best as possible an analysis of what the economic impacts of such a project as this might look like across all the various project sizes. Complete estimates of benefits and or costs are obviously nearly impossible at this point. We do have a few unknowns, though with each passing week, I think we start to get more information. So really the major unknown left for this project is the size and the scale of the project. Therefore, we thought it was best to show economic and fiscal impacts across a broad variety of sizes. So ultimately the size of the project is going to depend on some of the market dynamics yet. As the mayor mentioned in his opening comments, the legislation that is currently being considered allows for 5 cities in the Commonwealth to partake of gaming. As many of you know, the JLARC study that was done also threw in the possibility of a Northern Virginia casino. So we'll have to examine that as that moves forward. And then we also have additional economic analysis. So the agreement as it stands with the developers currently include payment on their side of certain one-time costs, those being primarily flood mitigation or what they refer to as resilience costs and infrastructure costs, which are basically the costs of supplying roadway and other infrastructures into the project site. So I would caution you, these estimates are preliminary. We feel very comfortable with the revenue estimates, and then the one-time cost estimates are still yet to be determined because they're largely going to depend on project size. But let me go through the project quickly. So Ordinance 47773 approved 2 documents laying out a partnership between the City of Norfolk, the Pamunkey Indian Tribe, and Golden Eagle Consulting 2. Those 2 documents were an option to purchase and then an intergovernmental agreement. And those documents allowed for either a tribal casino on the property or a commercial casino on the property you're seeing here. For the purposes of this presentation, you'll hear me refer to the figure 12.16 acres. And the reason I'm doing that is because though the subject property is nearly just a little over 13 acres, there's a piece of property, you can see this small little rectangular space to the east of the main property, which is really undevelopable at this point. So we're talking about trying to estimate fiscal and economic impacts off the developable parcel. Okay, so let's get into it. I think the most important part is this first slide. So this is just an initial analysis of some of the potential tax revenues to the city based on the current state. And so what we've done here is taken an overview of all the various project sizes. As you can see there, that varies by the number of slot machines, the number of tables, and the number of hotel rooms. And in a second, I'll show you a slide which is also tethering these project sizes to a capital investment that we believe is necessary to hit that project size. The column net gaming revenue provides the expectation of net gaming revenue that would accrue to this project of these various sizes. The next column next to that is tribal casino returns. So this is what is currently inside the agreement between the tribe, the developer, and the city. So this is a 4% off the top line net gaming rate. And so that's the number you see there. The next 2 columns then are the commercial route. So the first column underneath commercial casino is the gaming revenue that is projected to come to Norfolk via legislation. And I want to caution everyone on this. This Jay Lark themselves even alluded to the fact that, you know, this is, we don't know where this ends up yet. So Jay Lark took a median of some other gaming rates in other states. That's 27%. And then they took a 5% host city contribution out of that 27%. That's the number that you see here in this column. And then the final column is the everything else. So there is still a lot of ways to go yet in the legislation in terms of what other taxes the city is going to be allowed to collect. And so what I'm just showing you here is basically the gap between the known tribal tax revenue that would be generated versus the known tax revenue from gaming on the commercial side. This gap, so if you look at the first project size, is about $3.2 million. If that gap were to be made up for with real estate taxes, bed taxes on the hotels, sales taxes, and other taxes, then the commercial route would be more fiscally beneficial to the city than the tribal route. Again, that's just more of a thought experiment than anything, just to help get everybody to understand the two various paths. The other piece that I think is important to look at is sort of the capital investment. So Jay Lark does mention this and tries to take a look at this in their report. We did the same here. Here's what we come up with. We have projects in size from 1 to 6, smallest to largest. The smallest creating a capital investment of $200 million. The largest creating a capital investment of about $650 million. The Jay Lark report, this is table 3.1, only provides for three different sizes of capital investment, a $200 million and what that might look like, a $400 million and a $600 million. And I think as you can see, what we're getting in terms of ours is the there's significant one-time costs here with the potential resilience and the infrastructure, and so that could potentially influence some of what you're seeing between the difference between our numbers and the JLARC numbers. But in general, we're quite close to the JLARC numbers in terms of project sizes and capital investment. So just to summarize that pretty quickly, every project size is going to generate significant tax revenue to the city. It's very impressive given the project acreage of 12.16 acres of developable land. Right now, project size 2 is what closely aligns with what the JLARC prediction is. And I want to be very clear about that because I'm not thinking that everybody is crystal clear. We are not internally as staff saying that is the project size we end up with. We are saying right now that is the project size that aligns with what Jay Lark is predicting each city's project size may look like. Where we actually end up is still yet to be determined. A commercially operated facility clearly provides larger tax revenues beyond those that would be collected as a tribal casino. The one caveat here, and I think it's important to point out, the Jay Lark study also finds that there's a pretty significant interaction between the initial capital investment and the gaming tax rate. So for instance, if you were to look at just the case of Norfolk, if we were to move the tax rate in Norfolk, if the Commonwealth were to move the tax rate from 12% to 27%, that would result in an estimated $53 million initial investment in the project. Again, not saying good or bad, just saying that's something that would have to be evaluated when we got there. Also, I think what's important is to look at some employment impacts. So these are our internal staff calculations based off of a model that we built and then calibrated through Chimera Jobs EQ. All the project sizes produce about what we would refer to in the industry as a multiplier of about 1.26. So for every job, you get about 26% more generated through indirect and induced. And that's columns 3 and 4. The difference there between direct employment and total employment are the indirect and induced employment. We're pretty much in line with where JLARC was in terms of these project sizes. So for a project of $200 million investment, we're looking at about 643 direct jobs with about 906 total, a total compensation roughly around $44 million, and that equates to a median compensation of about $48,688. And in Norfolk, our current 2017 median income for a one-earner household was $42,003. A lot of conversation about the social impacts. We're pretty early in this analysis. Obviously, the project size is going to influence the actual estimates for social impact of this particular project. But we did go back into the literature and some of the academic work that's been done on pathological gaming. I'll let you sort of look through those slides, and these are posted on the website. A couple things to think about here. Number one is that the prevalence of pathological gaming doesn't seem to change with the addition of casinos. And that's important to keep in mind. However, what we know is that we have about 1 to 1.9% of adults in the city that are likely pathological gamers and have some issues with pathological gaming. JLARC suggests a prevalence rate somewhere between 0.8 and 2.9. Now, when you try to put dollar figures on this, it's hard, but there is one study that provides some guidance for us. Douglas Walker, he's a professor at the College of Charleston, did a study on Southern Nevada, and he found that problem gaming created a social cost of about $1,579 per gamer. This equates to about $1,885 in today's dollars. So we actually ran that through and tried to get some gauge of what we think current total costs of this, social costs of this, are in Norfolk. And let me be very clear here, this is a current number. This isn't even a number that would include the addition of anything else. So this is basically lottery, historical horse racing, and other types of gaming that are currently legal. And as you can see here, these numbers range anywhere from about $2.9 million up to about $6.5 million for the city. That's based on 192,000 individuals. So the funding of this is going to be very, very important. And one of the things they proposed in the JLARC study was that you could take some of the casino tax revenue that is being generated and then use a piece of that to help fund problem gaming. So I just looked at Norfolk, and I want to be very clear, this is a thought experiment, nothing more, because they're not going to lockbox this money. So they're not going to go in and say, okay, here's what Norfolk gives, and then here's what Norfolk gets back. This would be money that flowed to the state and then would be dispersed back out, with some, I think, preference for the host cities. So for a project size of one, we have our projected net gaming revenue. You see the 27% commercial Commonwealth tax rate there of $32,668,279. And then if you did a 0.7%, which is about the median for all the states that JLARC looked at, that would flow back about $228,000 to just the city of Norfolk. Obviously, that's well south of where that other number was in terms of what the costs could be. And so I think what you see in the JLARC report is a lot of conversation about the fact that the state currently underfunds this problem. And so as they think about moving forward with gaming in the Commonwealth, they'll have to keep a very clear eye on how we might be able to fund this going forward. The other one that's been a big piece of conversation has been the potential issues on crime. And really, the only way we can get at this currently is to just get our arms around what we think might be the average number of daily visits at the various project size levels. So we have projects, again, sizes 1 through 6, and that equates back to the other table I showed you in terms of the number of slots, the number of tables, and the number of hotel rooms. And then we just calculate an average daily number of visits. They range from 2,454 on the $200 million project all the way up to a number of daily visits upwards of 15,000. And so what we did when we were thinking about what would this potentially mean for police and fire and so on, we tried to calibrate that towards some events that we currently have that are in that range. With the opening of Waterside and the opening of the Main, there were no net new officers added to what's called the Green Sector, which is basically this whole downtown sector. And these numbers from project size 1, 2, and 3 are roughly in that vicinity of what we're seeing daily visits on average to that downtown area. if we look at sort of major events, Grand Illumination, Harbor Fest, things like that, where we're getting about 150 to 250,000 individuals, we typically staff up 8 to 10 additional FTEs for that particular type of an event. So again, we don't have an answer here, but that gives us a rough idea that, you know, if we're dealing with 2,454, 4,533. We think we're in the ballpark currently with staff that could handle those kinds of numbers. That's a conversation that obviously council, city staff, and the chief of police would have as we move forward and sort of narrow in on what the project size might actually be. So let me conclude here quickly so we can get to the comments by you all. Our estimates are actually quite in line with the JLARC study, so that was good news. I mean, we were happy to see that we weren't far off from where JLARC was. JLARC's prediction is for the city of Norfolk a $300 million project. That equates roughly to our $375 million project. It doesn't add up perfectly because this isn't just a smooth transition from 200 to 210. There's some engineering that has to take place, so you don't necessarily go from 200 just straight to 300. We still have a ways to go, all right, and I think that's really the moral on my end, is the staff is fully prepared to continue to do this analysis as the legislation during the General Assembly session moves forward and we start to get a clearer picture of where this project may end up. I think it's safe to say that no matter what project size we're looking at positive fiscal impacts to the city, particularly since in the agreement currently there are one-time costs of resilience and infrastructure that are currently being covered by the developer and not the city. But we'll obviously continue to do this analysis as the General Assembly session plays out, and we'll report back to everyone as we get more firm numbers when we start to get closer to exactly what project size we might be looking at. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Filer. Mrs. Michelle Foy.
So a lot of this is review. Good evening. Senate Bill 1126, just to summarize, allows commercial casino gaming in five localities, Bristol, Danville, Norfolk, Portsmouth, and Richmond, allows development of one casino in each locality, allows a tribe, it's not identified by name, but the Pamunkey tribe essentially to operate two casinos, one in Norfolk and one in Richmond, as a commercial casino operator. And the bill requires a referendum in each locality and requires a minimum capital investment of $200 million by the developer. The terms of the proposed agreement, based on what you've heard tonight, with us not going down the tribal road, we will simply have an option agreement. It's between the city, the tribe, and the tribe's developer. The tribe and its developer are permitted to exercise the option only after they have a final approved right to operate a commercial casino at the site. There were questions at the last meeting as to whether or not they could buy it without developing, and that is one of the requirements. Purchase price is $750,000 per acre for a total purchase price of $9.9 million. The other agreement that we had approved back in September was an intergovernmental agreement. There will be no intergovernmental agreement as it's not required in the commercial casino scenario. The option agreement is being modified to suit the new solely commercial scenario. And this means that the land will not become sovereign land, that instead of 4% revenues that were described in the IGA, it'll be a project like any other in the city with taxes and like any other development. So. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Filer, and thank you, Ms. Foy. Before we call our first speaker, I do want to recognize members of the Gaming Committee. I see Louis Eisenberg, Vivian Page, Lawrence Brown, Danica Royster, Peggy Scott, and also Jason Inge, Mamie Johnson, and, of course, Tommy Spiegel. Thank you for being here. And thank you for your service. The first speaker is Danny Lee Ginn.
My name is Danny Lee Ginn. I reside at 3844 Dare Circle. I come here tonight to ask Kenny Alexander, Martin Thomas, Mamie Johnson, Tommy Smeagol, Mrs. Graves, and Mrs. Doyle to offer an apology to the citizens of the city for the incompetent and misleading information you have provided to the city and to the citizens in regards to the casino. We have asked you at the meeting on September 24th to slow down the process. You did a lot of wheeling and dealing behind closed doors, and we asked you to slow down so that we could see what was actually taking place. You ignored that request. You followed the instruction of Chief Graves. You voted to continue to negotiate with him over our objection, which in turn forced the people of the city to have to collect signatures in order to force you to back away from the area that you were going. This is very offensive to, I think, most citizens in the city. We asked you to work with us, and you failed to ignore to do so. At the same time, we had Andrea McCullen, who stood with the people of the city. I think she should be recognized for her integrity, for letting us know that she was as just confused as the citizens were in regards to what was going on with the casino. She showed honesty in the fact of stepping forward and putting her viewpoints very sternly before us. And she showed transparency in reading the entire 200 pages that came out from the General Assembly, using the facts and the figures to justify her position for standing with the people. And that is greatly, greatly appreciated.
Mr. Ginn, let me just respond. On January the 29th of 2019, the council, this entire council, with the exception of Mr. Smeagol, who wasn't here, passed a resolution in January. Every member of this council voted for it except Mr. Smeagol because he was not here. And this is what the resolution did. A resolution of the council of the city of Norfolk supporting new legislation that would allow a federally recognized Native American tribe authorized to conduct gaming under federal law to operate a casino in the city of Norfolk. This was January of 2019. On September the 24th, in the resolution that we passed, 47773, the council was very clear that a commercial casino was always an option, and more importantly, that the city attorney, the city manager, will amend, correct, and revise the intergovernmental agreement and the option to purchase in the best interests of the city council. Now, let's not be surprised that a developer who proposed to build a project in the city of Norfolk or any city overstate their projections. This is why we took the due diligence from day one and did not sign either the intergovernmental agreement, nor did we sign the purchase option agreement so that we could do our own analysis and our own study. And so after months of listening, analysis, and conversation, and more importantly, participation from the citizens, we have come to the amendments that we're offering tonight. Thank you, Mr. Ginn, for being here. Next speaker is David Scott.
My name is David Scott. I live at 718 Sparrow Road in Majestic Chesapeake. Mr. Mayor, esteemed members of the City Council and City Manager, good evening. I would first like to thank you for this opportunity to speak with you tonight, but I would also like to take this time to thank my beautiful wife, Cynthia, who accompanied me here this evening. She is my strength, my happiness, my inspiration, and without her, I would not even be here. Let me be first to say thank you all for your service, a Merry Christmas and best wishes for a prosperous and joyous New Year. There was talk about needing money for problems concerning gambling addiction, which could arise from building this casino. I realize I'm not as learned as the members of the City Council or the Mayor, But perhaps you can enlighten me why money needs to be made available for gambling addiction when there are free programs on hand which support groups like GamblersAnonymous.org, GamblingTherapy.org, as well as Recovery.org, which features a Gamblers Anonymous 12-step program or even the church. If addiction is the problem, then Jesus Christ is certainly the answer. We are told in the book of Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There is certainly no better, wiser, or higher authority than the Lord for seeking counsel and wisdom. Fellowship with the church community, pastor, or minister is a great place to start for any addiction, and it's completely free of charge. I would also ask why problem gambling is an issue when we have problem drinking right here in Hampton Roads. Alcohol addiction poses more of a threat than gambling addiction, as drunk drivers will kill innocent citizens on the roads and highways every year, yet I have heard nothing from this council concerning the possibility of prohibition to resolve that issue. I know a petition was brought before City Council to repeal the vote to build a casino. My question to you, Honorable Mayor and esteemed members of the City Council, is, did anyone bother to check the names on the petition for legitimacy? We need to make sure that there was no fudging on this document. I'm simply asking if the signed names on the petition were verified by an unbiased source. Councilwoman Graves, you were most kind, ensuring all questions were posed at the last meeting on Monday were answered. I humbly ask for that same consideration again here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, I would be damn proud to play at our newly established casino once it is built. I play Texas Hold'em Tournament Poker, and not to toot my own horn, but I'm pretty good at it. As it stands currently, it costs $30 to cross Chesapeake Bay Bridge both ways to play at either Dover, Delaware, or Atlantic City, New Jersey. This money could better be collected by citizens coming from out of state wanting to visit our casino, giving the local citizens of Hampton Roads a break on travel expenses. The casino itself will create a boost in employment as well as to our local economy. Further, the casino is a venue much like the boathouse before it was destroyed by Hurricane Isabel. This means the casino will support major popular entertainment acts who will bring in more profits. This translates to financial gains, prosperity, and more room for growth and stability. Finally, I would like to finish by reminding the mayor and city council that America remains the greatest country in the world today because our ancestors and forefathers took a chance. They took risk at great odds because they believed in something greater than themselves. This casino is a low-risk, high-gain opportunity for our local community. Build this casino, and let's get Hampton Roads. Let's make Hampton Roads great again.
Thank you so much. Peggy Scott, followed by William Stiles.
Hello. Excuse me. My name is Peggy Scott, and I live at 8405 Frieden Street in the great 757. Okay. Things have changed since the Monday night meeting, but the tribe is still on board with the casino in Norfolk. Once the General Assembly passes the bill SB 1126 this year, the surrounding cities of Portsmouth, Richmond, and our city of Norfolk will have a better idea as to what, when, and how the casinos will be coming to Virginia. The Pamunkey tribe is still willing to build a world-class casino in Norfolk, even if it is a smaller in size than the original. They are still willing to purchase the land, and if commercial gaming is what is passed, they can still partner with us in that endeavor. The tribe can still seek to buy any other ancestral land and pursue tribal gaming, which would eliminate the much-needed money that would come to Norfolk. If the commercial route is taken, land is not put into trust. Hopefully, they will choose our downtown waterfront for the casino. A casino would be a great asset to our city and would complement the Wave Complex being built in Virginia Beach. That would be a great start to act in a regional manner and would put the 757 on the map. I have heard people say they don't want gambling or gaming coming to Norfolk, but it's already here. Walk into the many bars, clubs, and restaurants, and you see the gray machines everywhere. They are even in 7-Elevens. They are presently unregulated, and the revenue generated from them isn't even taxed. Gaming is here, and it's not going away. So let's be at the forefront of getting a casino in our city and reap the benefits of the extra money it will provide. Thank you.
Thank you. William Stiles, followed by Jamari Hugglebrook.
I'm William Stiles. I live at 1121 Graydon Avenue in Norfolk. Dr. Filer, members of council, I was at the last meeting and brought up the issue of the applicability of the city's resilience ordinance and a number of locally administered environmental programs like the Chesapeake Bay Preservation Act to tribal land because of its sovereign nature. If this is going to be developed as a commercial casino and the land does not become a sovereign land, then the development will have all of the Norfolk Resilience Ordinance and all the Chesapeake Bay Preservation Acts applied to it. And so our objections to this would be nullified. We'll keep a close eye on this. What was it Ronald Reagan said? Trust but verify. We'll continue to monitor this, but thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Stiles. Jamari, followed by Emmanuel Kaysen, Sr. Bob Layton, you follow Kaysen.
My name is Jamari Hoggebrook, reside at 320 Frizzell Avenue, Norfolk, Virginia, 23502. Thank you, Mayor Alexander, council members, for the opportunity to speak in front of you in regards to this matter. I am neither pro nor anti-casino, but I do hope that the introduction of more information will help with my decision. The southern land in the Harbor Park area will amount to nearly $10 million. The Pamunkey Indian Tribes is willing to pay that amount along with funding the project with no help from the city. My question is no financial help from the city set in stone? Construction estimates and actualities have always deviated regardless of the project. I'm curious that if the Pamunkey Indian Tribe would need extra funds for the construction, would the city provide that? Furthermore, of the $10 million being made from the land sale, how many of it is going to the schools? And of that percentage, how much of that is going to increase the wages of our hardworking teachers that work day in and day out to sharpen the minds of the kids of the future? Over the past 15 years, teachers' wages in Virginia have decreased by 10%. Making it harder for said teachers to maintain their livelihood, as well as attract potential teachers looking to make the Hampton Roads area their new home. And finally, if teachers receive a pay raise, will their insurance premiums increase as well? There's been a trend with teachers' salaries that an increase in wages also increases the amount of money they spend on insurance. I'm not sure if this question directly relates to the matters at hand, but if it does, it should be addressed accordingly. A 4% increase in teachers' wages should not be stifled by an increase in premium costs, making the net wage increase no. Thank you for your time, and I hope you can answer the questions accordingly.
Thank you very much. Mr. Kaysen, followed by Emmanuel Kaysen, followed by Bob Layton. Is Mr. Kaysen here? Okay.
If there was a guy close to me like that.
All right. Well, you up. Followed by Bob Layton.
Leaders for the city, I am Gary, I'll now say Emmanuel Kaysen, Jr., and there are a few Kaysens running around. I was in attendance at my alma mater earlier this week. I went to Granby. I was born and raised in Norfolk. I currently live at 1320 Debris Avenue. And when I came, my position was more of just needing additional information, and I got that. And I appreciated the mayor's comments at the end of the presentation. I did not think I'd be coming back for a second time, but I had to because it changed my position. I don't think I was anti-casino before, but certainly after hearing the mayor and the other leaders, it caused me to shift my thinking to being much more open to this process. I think a big thing for me was the fact that the city would not lose the control over what happens in our city. That was a big thing for me. I also started to look at what a difference it could make for the Amtrak service, which to the credit of this council has expanded in Norfolk. We no longer have to catch a bus over to Newport News to get up to DC and New York. Maybe that service expands more. Additionally, maybe the light rail gets an infusion from this facility being there. I also took a look that it is gaming, but it's also entertainment. And I thought of the ancillary benefits that would come to the area because of all that it would offer. So I just want to thank you, Mayor. I want to thank you, everyone, for causing me to take a position that is more open to this idea and more open for this great city that we all live in. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob Layton, followed by David Brenner.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of staff, I hope you all have, and your families, a very happy holiday season. I'm Bob Layton, 1501 Bayville Street, Norfolk. I will continue to refer to that as Norfolk and not 757. I'm proud of my long residency here and proud of my city. I come here tonight to speak in support of the vote that you have taken on this initiative. On its face, it's a simple land use disposition agreement. But having had the opportunity to participate in past years in many such considerations, it is for sure a complex strategy of how to best position our city in its relationship to actions that are going to be taken by the state of Virginia. Your vote has positioned the citizens of this city to be in a good position to get the most benefit out of whatever comes out of the state legislature. And I congratulate you on that. This is without a doubt the most diverse representative city council that has ever existed in this city, for sure. The fact that 7 of 8 of you stood shoulder to shoulder on this vote told me a great deal about its complexity and about the wisdom of the vote that you took. So again, thank you. Let's get on with it. And those of us, I think, in large majority that call Willoughby home, not 757, will support you. Thank you.
David Brenner, followed by Kevin Craigsball.
David Brenner, 2204 Halperin Court. Good evening, Mayor, Dr. Alexander, city leaders, and Team Norfolk. I come here this evening for my continued support for the tribe and also the Norfolk Casino Resort. I also come here to ask the city to move forward with this project. I ask this as this mayor and body has continued to be patient, has not conveyed the property, even though it was voted 7-1 in September 2019. It has addressed any concerns that there may be from all citizens of Norfolk and also the Informed Norfolk Group. Just the past couple months, the city has taken out time for concerns at city council meetings, at 2 public hearings. They waited for the JLARC study, and now our mayor announced that the city will be going forward with a commercial casino route. With this commercial casino route, this will not be sovereign land. The city and state will have control of any issues that could potentially arise inside and outside of the property. Now this casino will have real estate, hotel, food, beverage, and any other taxes that is required with a commercial casino. In addition, there were concerns on funding of monies to go to schools from Councilwoman McCullen and Councilman Smiegel. As promised by this body, $9.9 million from the sale of the property will go to 2 Norfolk Public Schools High School for much needed repairs. And also, the commercial casino will provide additional revenues that will go into a full funding formula that goes directly for Norfolk Public Schools. To end this, the citizens of Norfolk will decide to get their voice by voting on whether or not they want a casino in Norfolk 2020. I believe the city, our leaders, and Team Norfolk have been there for all citizens of Norfolk and gave citizens all a voice, and now I kindly ask that we allow them to go to work for the better of all citizens and our city as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you. Kevin Craigsball, followed by Amanda Lloyd.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and City Council. My name is Kevin Krigsold. I am a 25-year resident of Norfolk. I'm also a member of the Pamunkey Indian Tribe. I grew up on the reservation. I moved to Norfolk to attend Old Dominion University, and I've been here pretty much ever since. I just came here again tonight to mention that the tribe is completely committed to working with Norfolk to move this project forward. We have for the past 400 years, we've been diminished slowly, and we finally have an opportunity to get a leg up and start moving forward, and this project was going to help our tribe tremendously, and as a 25-year resident of Norfolk, it's going to help this city tremendously as well. So I just wanted to come and offer my support again, offer the tribe support, and thank you for your vote earlier. Thank you.
Thank you. Amanda Lloyd, followed by Phil Smith.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council members, staff, and my fellow residents. As an academic and involved community leader, I've become an informed citizen and heavily weighed what this project means for Norfolk now and 15, 20 years from now. The word casino has a negative stereotype. However, I remind you, it's not just a standalone casino, but a luxury resort with amenities such as a potential casino and hotel rooms, spa, restaurants, and space for entertainers. I've spent hours on extensive research, and any citizen can become informed on their own, and I empower everyone to seek factual information and formulate their own thoughts. We all have different opinions, and that's a good thing. However, it is my hope for civility and a healthy debate, whether you agree or disagree. There are many other issues and needs to be addressed in our city, as this project has taken up the last 3 months of that. And it's truly saddening to see the division occurring, as we should all strive to be united on all fronts. I'm in support of the land sale, and I support the potential casino resort and entertainment venue. And I entrust our elected officials to make the best informed decisions on behalf of our citizens based on the information that they have been receiving over the last year and a half. This plot of land for sale has been laying fallow for well over a decade, is in serious need of costly work due to its location in a very flood-prone area to be structurally sound to conduct a business venture. This is the first time I've ever seen or heard of a city transaction where we're not giving any big tax breaks or discounts away. The tribe is willing to pay fair market value for this waterfront property. Why not sell this land? This is a win-win for the city. No more empty, flood-prone lot, and we get approximately $10 million. As a municipality, there's only so many ways in which we can produce revenue, and when we are in a deficit, this means our budget regression analysis and projections were not on point. We did not get the revenues that we thought we would due to various economic factors in regards to those predictions. When there is not enough money to pay our bills, such as the salaries of our public service employees, keeping services going, such as trash and recycling collection, and providing resources such as free library books and programs, we have had to cut services in the city and lay off employees. This is why we need this revenue in which the resort venue would bring to our city. I'm tired of hearing over and over and year after year, we just don't have enough money. Well, here's an opportunity, and these don't come along too often. The council does not have the authority to approve a casino. This is a state matter, and elements of gaming have already made its way into the Commonwealth as of 2018. This is not an in-the-bag done deal. As of this upcoming General Assembly session, the conversations will continue to allow or not allow other levels of gaming throughout Virginia. After reviewing the JLARC study, many noted the variance in the projections, and I feel it was a very wise move for the Pamunkey tribe to switch from tribal to commercial, as this was always an option on the table. This change will truly benefit both the city and the tribe, and I commend our city and tribal leaders for coming to this conclusion. In addition, it means potential tax revenues designated for Norfolk Public Schools and a new funding formula, as this has been a constant question in regards to the allocation of funds for our schools. The GA does allow expansion of gaming, and it is approved through the Senate Bill 1126. Our city knows that we will need to be 100% proactive in increasing public safety personnel, yeah, in addition to our human and social services. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lord. Phil Smith, followed by Stephen King.
Mr. Mayor, City Council, City Manager, City Staff, my name is Phil Smith. I'm a business owner in Norfolk, and I live in Chesapeake. I own the Brick Anchor Brew House, which many of you have frequented. And I'm here to first thank you for the opportunity coming out and hearing from the residents and your citizens. I am going to bring a little bit different focus from some of the conversations in the past, and mine is going to be focused more on the impact to small businesses. I feel that from what I have seen today and from what I have read and from what I understand to be true is that there has not been a wealth of analysis conducted regarding the impact of a casino, especially with restaurants and a captive audience, so to speak, on the local economic engine of our small businesses. It's my understanding, again, from owning business here and also in New York, where casinos have had an impact, that in order to really benefit a community, approximately 60 to 65% of people who frequent the casino should come from outside of the footprint, and it's so therefore the money is not just being spread around that's currently in this market between different establishments, but that we are also benefiting from money coming from outside. Now, I don't know if it's true. Not everything in a pilot is true, of course, but I saw recently a new projection is about 10% from outside of the footprint. Now, if that is accurate, what happens here is that you are going to find restaurant, especially restaurant closures. I'm also the chair of the Downtown Restaurant Coalition for Norfolk. And there is much concern about from some of the members, because not only do we now have a captive audience going to the casino who are likely going to stay there because they are locals, we also have, and it's a great thing for the community, as per the slide, 1,400 or whatever it was jobs with a medium income of plus 40,000 plus, outstanding. At the same time, small businesses in the community compete for the same pool for many of those workers. So you have to do some strategic analysis on what is going to be the impact on your small businesses. If we cannot hire local citizens to work in our restaurants, we will fail. Couple that with a very likely minimum wage increase, and your restaurants in downtown Norfolk, especially the small businesses that aren't partnered with the city, or are small, will not survive. I, for one, will tell you, in all honesty, I am pretty upfront, retired Army officer, if the casino opens, I will close. And that is not a threat. That is just trying to be strategic, because I'm going to sell my building, and I'm going to take what I can get before everything pans out, unless there is help from the city. And I have not really heard any discussion of the impact on small businesses.
Thank you,
for
sir.
That, I'm saddened.
Thank you so much. Stephen King.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Stephen King, no relation. I'm here from Hampton this evening because the decision of this casino is going to impact the entire Hampton Roads positively, I believe. I'm very pro-casino. A little backstory about me, I went to VCU for 4 years. I've studied business, so I have a pretty good idea of what the definition of economic improvement is and how to do it. And I unfortunately couldn't finish school because I got in a bad car accident, which I'm still recovering from. But I'm back in school right now, and when I graduate, I have plans of going out to Las Vegas and studying hospitality at UNLV for 2 semesters, then pursuing a career as a concierge in downtown Las Vegas. So I go out there pretty often, and I have a pretty professional opinion about it because I don't go out there to party or have fun. I go out there pretty professionally and speak to corporate people in the casinos. And I've learned some very, 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 very lucrative material, such as in the casinos in Las Vegas, the average dishwasher, the person just goes around and collects dishes and washes them, they make $26 an hour, they work 60 hours a week, they're making $60,000 a year as a dishwasher. Here in Hampton Roads, it's just really tough to even find a job, period. I mean, I have a question for the city council. Would it be beneficial for y'all to be able to tax a couple $60,000 a year salaries? I mean, because imagine what this money we could do with it. We could do it to improve our roads, our schools, and improve our police forces, which is really just a benefit to the entire area. Not to mention the definition of improving the economy is bringing in money from other areas. I mean, we have downtown Norfolk is a mere 10 miles away from a beautiful Atlantic Ocean beach. And we have the tide train system to transport people from downtown Norfolk to the beach, which is really improve the economy of everywhere in Hampton Roads. But this is people coming from other areas spending their disposable income at our local shops and stores, going to our restaurants, going to our local shops, and really just helping people. And the more our businesses are going to expand and the more sales they make, the more help they're going to need. That's providing more and more jobs for our local citizens. Plus our citizens making the big money at the casino, working there. That's money they're going to spend, reinvest locally and make more money for our local businesses. When I speak to people about this, the only real opposition I hear is people are saying it's going to invite the criminal element to our community. Let me tell you, I've been to Las Vegas many times. The safest I've ever felt was walking down Las Vegas Boulevard. That city has so much money coming in from the casinos that they've invested a lot of it in their police force. I hope that wasn't my time to stop, but there's a policeman in every single block in Las Vegas. Like, the one thing that's impossible in Las Vegas is to get away with a crime. That's why the movie Ocean's 11 is very not true.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. King, for coming.
Can I mention one more thing?
Yes, sir. Go right on.
Another opposition here is Sin City. People think bringing a casino here is just going to bring a bunch, it's going to turn to the stereotype of Las Vegas. But the state of Virginia is very conservatively governed. As long as we have conservative officials, we're not going to let this get out of hand. I really think that our government's going to step in and make sure that everybody's safe and everybody's having a good time and while making us a little bit more money.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, sir. Dr. Feiler, there were a few questions, and Ms. Ford, there were a few questions. Jamari asked a question about the initial revenue, the pre-development revenue, and the revenue from the sale of the land. They also reference going commercial, the 14 buckets. He alluded to the 14 buckets that we will share with Norfolk Public Schools under a commercial casino. Will you please respond?
Yes, sir. The one of the questions that was asked in all of that was the subsidies. Would the city have an agreement that excluded subsidies? And that's to be determined. I mean, we'll work on the development agreement now. The original agreement included no subsidies from the city of Norfolk, the amendments that are being made to the agreement to remove the land going into tribal trust, are the only amendments we're making to the new development agreement. So everything else would remain the same. So as of currently, there would be no subsidies that are being offered in the new development agreement. We do have a funding formula in the city. So one of the concerns by the JLARC report, a well-deserved concern, is that this may have an impact on the lottery, which would potentially then divert money from the lottery. If you look at the JLARC report, finds that the state overall would receive about $396 million. And what's important there is that $396 million in tax revenue is net of what they were baking in as a $60 million contribution to fill the donut hole that could possibly happen in the lottery. In addition to that, at the state level, at the city level, the commercial route opens up these tax revenues for our funding formula, which means that funding to the school system occurs automatically with the increase in these types of tax revenues. I believe those were the primary ones. Was there another? I think those were the primary ones for that particular individual.
Yes, the pre-development revenue and the revenue from the land sale.
So the revenue from the land sale was a vote that council took shortly after the original vote on the ordinance. The land sale proceeds will be split currently between Booker T. Washington and Maury High School. I couldn't remember the pre-development question. That was the pre-development
question. Same answer. Yeah. Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
On that,
Mr. McClellan? Yes, go right on.
Couple things. That was a resolution, not the ordinance originally that we passed regarding the land sale proceeds. It wasn't part of the ordinance itself.
Yeah, correct. That was a subsequent vote.
So, a lot of this has changed substantively since we voted on September 24th. We're talking about amendments, corrections, and revisions, which we haven't seen as council or discussed as council, nor have we voted on them as a council. And while I'm pleased to see that in writing, the intergovernmental agreement will not be signed, because that was a concern of mine initially about a forever deal. That was one of my opposition when I voted. I would suggest that as a council, we also pass a resolution that states that we will not be signing the intergovernmental agreement and that the land not be put into trust. Because at this point, tomorrow, the city could sign that. Is that correct? It has the authority to under the ordinance that was passed on September 24th.
The intergovernment agreement will not be signed. Part of the revisions and the corrections and the amendments, we have decided, the manager, the city attorney, and I have met every day over the last couple of months working, doing our due diligence, and part of the revision is not to sign the intergovernmental agreement. There will be no intergovernmental agreement. The authority was given to the manager and to the city attorney on September 24th, Ordinance 47773, authorize the revisions, the amendments, and the corrections that they deem necessary and that they deem in the best interest of the city. And it's been concluded that no intergovernmental agreement will be signed, no land would be put into trust, and now we only have before us an option to purchase, along with complying and conforming to Senate Bill 1126 of the Virginia General Assembly, which laid out a couple of things, that there will be five cities that could host commercial gaming in the Commonwealth of Virginia: Bristol, Danville, Richmond, Portsmouth, and Norfolk. Number two, that a referendum would have to be passed that will permit a commercial gaming operation in those host cities in November of 2020. The voters in Norfolk will ultimately decide. They will be the final decider, our voters. We will be, as a collective body, whether or not gaming is commercial gaming at that level is something that we will allow. And third, the General Assembly put in Senate Bill 1126 a reenactment provision, that this provision, 1126, has to be reenacted, voted on by the Virginia General Assembly, both chambers, House and Senate, in identical form, and then signed by the governor. We have decided that if there's going to be that level of commercial gaming in Norfolk, that it will go through that process. The second piece of the revisions, corrections, and amendments, that a gaming committee should be formed. And that gaming committee has been formed for additional oversight, to continue to engage and to provide analysis of all forms of gaming that's present currently and proposed in the Commonwealth of Virginia. And that committee is chaired by Mr. Smigel and Mrs. Johnson. And so the work has been a legislative work. It started in January of this year, on January 29th. This council, everyone on this council except Mr. Smigel, because he was absent, passed a resolution and the resolution that every member who's seated here tonight, except Mr. Smigel because he was sick, passed a resolution. And let me read what this council passed to start the legislative process. A resolution of the Council of the City of Norfolk, Virginia, supporting new legislation that would allow a federally recognized Native American tribe authorized to conduct gaming under federal law to operate a casino in the city of Norfolk. Every member on this dais voted aye. Mr. Smigel was excused. Mr. Riddick voted aye, but he's not here tonight. Part of this, what we have been doing from the very beginning is listening, doing physical analysis, feasibility studies, and again, no one should be surprised when a developer overstate their numbers. That should not be a surprise to anyone. We didn't sign because we wanted to conduct our own analysis, our own physical impact, and we have done that. And now we're at the conclusion to make some amendments to the intergovernmental agreement, which that's going to be deleted, and only the option to purchase is what we have before us.
So, Mr. Mayor, are we going to have the opportunity to vote on those changes, is my question.
We voted to allow those changes on September 24th in Section 2 of Ordinance 4773, authorizing the manager and the city attorney to make the amendments, make the corrections, make the revisions. We voted for them to do that.
Mr. Mayor, the Maine has often been brought up in these discussions. It's been very interesting. And one of the comments has been that it was a big taxpayer. There were a lot of incentives paid to the developer. And in that deal, I think originally, and I apologize, I wasn't on city council. I wasn't part of the vote for the actual number of the incentives. I was on the planning commission. We decided what it would look like and special exception for entertainment. But I think it was something around $85 million was the original amount. And because in that agreement, similar to this one, there was an opportunity for the city manager and the city attorney to make any changes, those changes ended up costing the taxpayers $110 million. And those weren't necessarily voted on by council subsequently. I'm just concerned about when we allow the manager and the attorney to make such substantive changes, and we're not being discussed in council, that's a concern of mine.
Yeah, I agree with 100%. Nor the manager or the city attorney can spend taxpayer money. They don't have the authority to appropriate, to dispense funds that we have not approved in a budget.
And I believe that the main project actually was in the contract that allowed them to go beyond the amount. So I think that was written in there because that was one of my oppositions to it.
Mr. Pischko, our city attorney, or Dr. Fowler, if you have the authority to spend taxpayer money that was not appropriated, please point out where in the code, the city code, that you have that authority. Mr. Pischko, do you have that authority?
No, you're correct that in Virginia, the only body that can appropriate is the city council.
Thank
you,
sir.
Through your budget, and that's it. It's constitutional. It's the only means of appropriation.
Thank you. Are there no other questions?
Yeah.
From the council.
Always.
Mr. Ginn, it's always good to see you. This meeting is adjourned.